Little Rabbit lay under the bedclothes with just his head peeping out, and listened. The room was to be disinfected, and all the books and toys that the boy had played with in bed must be burnt. "Hurrah!" thought the little rabbit. "Tomorrow we shall go to the seaside," for the boy had often talked about the seaside, and he wanted very much to see the big waves coming in, and the tiny crabs, and the sand castles. Just then Nana caught sight of him. "How about this old bunny?" she asked. "That?" said the doctor. "Why, it's a mass of scarlet fever germs. Burn it at once." "What? Nonsense. Get him a new one. He mustn't have that one any more." Anxious times. And so the little rabbit was put in a sack with the old picture books and a lot of rubbish, and carried to the end of the garden behind the fowl house. That was a fine place to make a bonfire. Only the gardener was too busy just then to attend to it. He had the potatoes to dig and the green peas to gather, but the next morning he promised he would come in quite early and burn the whole lot. That night the boy slept in a different bedroom. He had a new bunny to sleep with. It was a splendid bunny, all white plush with real glass eyes, but the boy was too excited to care very much about it. For tomorrow he was going to the seaside, and that in itself was such a wonderful thing that he could think of nothing else. And while the boy was asleep, dreaming of the seaside, the little rabbit lay among the old picture books in the corner behind the fowl house, and he felt very lonely. The sack had been left untied, and so by wriggling a bit he was able to get his head through the opening and look out. He was shivering a little, for he had always been used to sleeping in a proper bed, and by this time his coat had worn so thin and threadbare from hugging that it was no longer any protection to him. Nearby he could see the thicket of raspberry canes growing tall and close like a tropical jungle, in whose shadow he had played with the boy on bygone mornings. He thought of those long sunlit hours in the garden, how happy they were, and great sadness came over him. He seemed to see them all pass before him, each more beautiful than the other. The fairy huts in the flower bed, the quiet evenings in the wood, when he lay in the bracken and the little ants ran over his paws, the wonderful day when he first knew that he was real. He thought of the skin horse, so wise and gentle, and all that he had told him. Of what use was it to be loved and lose one's beauty and become real if it all ended like this? And a tear, a real tear, trickled down his little shabby velvet nose and fell to the ground. And then a strange thing happened. For where the tear had fallen, a flower grew out of the ground, a mysterious flower, not at all like any that grew in the garden. It had slender green leaves and the color of emeralds, and in the center of the leaves was a blossom like a golden cup. It was so beautiful that the little rabbit forgot to cry. He just lay there watching it. And presently the blossom opened, and out of it there stepped a fairy. She was quite the loveliest fairy in the whole world. Her dress was of pearl and dewdrops, and there were flowers around her neck and in her hair. And her face was like the most perfect flower of all. And she came close to the little rabbit and gathered him up in her arms and kissed him on his velveteen nose that was all damp from crying. "Little rabbit," she said, "don't you know who I am?" The rabbit looked up at her, and it seemed to him that he had seen her face before, but he couldn't think of where. "I am the nursery magic fairy," she said. "I take care of all the playthings that children have loved when they are old and worn out and the children don't need them any more. Then I come and take them away with me and turn them into real." "Wasn't I real before?" asked the little rabbit. "You were real to the boy," the fairy said, "because he loved you. Now you shall be real to everyone, the fairy flower." And she held the little rabbit close in her arms and flew with him into the wood. It was light now, for the moon had risen. All the forest was beautiful, and the fronds of the bracken shone like frosted silver. In the open glade, between the tree trunks, the wild rabbits danced with their shadows on the velvet grass. But when they saw the fairy, they all stopped dancing and stood round her in a ring to stare at her. "I brought you a new playfellow," the fairy said. "You must be very kind to him and teach him all he needs to know in Rabbit Land, for he's going to live with you forever and ever." And she kissed the little rabbit again and put him down on the grass. "Run and play, little rabbit," she said. But the little rabbit sat quite still for a moment and never moved, for he saw all the wild rabbits dancing around him, suddenly remembered that he didn't about his hind legs, and he didn't want them to see he was made all in one piece. He didn't know that when the fairy kissed him that last time, she had changed him altogether. And he might have sat there a long time, too shy to move, if just then something hadn't tickled his nose. And before he thought what he was doing, he lifted his hind toe to scratch it, and he found that he actually had hind legs. Instead of dingy velveteen, he had brown fur, soft and shiny. His ears twitched by themselves, and his whiskers were so long they brushed the grass. He gave one leap, and the joy of using those hind legs was so great that he went springing about the turf on them, jumping sideways and whirling around as the others did. And he grew so excited that when at last he did stop and look for the fairy, she had gone. He was a real rabbit at last, at home with the other rabbits. At last, at last. Autumn passed, and the winter. And in the spring, when the days grew warm and sunny, the boy went out to play in the wood behind the house. And while he was playing, two rabbits crept out from the bracken and peeped at him. One of them was brown all over, but the other had strange markings under his fur, as though long ago he had been spotted, and the spots still showed through. And about his little soft nose and his round black eyes, there was something familiar. So that the boy thought to himself, "Why, he looks just like my old bunny that I had that was lost when I had scarlet fever." But he never knew that it really was his old bunny, his own bunny, come back to look at the child who had first helped him to be real. The end.